Everybody, welcome to Timberland Fellowship. We're glad you guys can join us. If you can go ahead and greet each other real quick and say hi to everybody. If you haven't already, I'm sure you have, but do it again. Hey, all kinds of love going around the room. It's Christmas time, so. So glad you can join us this morning. It's cold, you know, it's crazy. I always talk about the weather, and I'm sorry, okay? It's just, I'm Mr. California, and I just can't get over it, how cold it is sometimes. But it actually was only 43 degrees, but there was, like, frost outside my house. And I was like, did you see that, sister? Because we live on the same street, right? And I looked, and I was like, I even refreshed my weather app, and I thought, you know, is this wrong? And no, it was 43, but there was frost out there. And so it's just, I think the Lord's messing with me. You know, I think he's playing a joke on me. So anyway, again, welcome. So glad you guys can join us. We do have a few announcements to give, and we're going to do something different today. After the announcements, we're going to let the Children's Church kids come up, and they want to sing a few Christmas songs for you. And I think Miss Delia, you're going to lead. You're going to help lead them? Oh, okay. Okay. anyway, so really quickly... She's my wife, but she's my sister in the Lord first, you know what I'm saying? So I got to play these little jokes on her. Next week, we are going to have just a regular Sunday service. It's going to be our normal time, 10:30. We won't have an evening service. There will be no, like, candlelight service, anything like that. And the reason why is because it's Christmas Eve. And so we thought we could do church together, and then you guys can get going with your festivities with your families and your friends and have all of Christmas Eve and then Christmas Day to do your thing. But we still want to have a service and come together because we are family in the Lord. And so it's important that we do that. So it'll be normal time next week. Sister Jeannie, thank you so much. I just want to thank the Lord for her. She made some invitations. So when you leave today, they're on the greeting table back here. If you could grab a stack, she actually even put paper clips, I think, on clumps of them. If you could just grab a stack and then hand them out to family and friends to invite them to Christmas service next week. And I promise you, it will be, today we'll be finishing up Colossians, so it will be a traditional, more Christmas-type message than we have done in the past. So if you can grab some invitations, invite people, that's really a good way for you to really partake in the mission, just inviting people in your community to church. The second thing I want to talk about is Men's Fellowship Bible Study. That will be this Tuesday, December 19th at Chris Wilson's house. Is that still on, brother? All right. And Chris, if you guys have any questions on where his address is, please ask him, and maybe you could send us, you could text the group your address. Thanks, brother. And that will be at 6 o'clock at Chris's house this Tuesday again. And then we're going to have Women's Fellowship Bible Study starting up again in the new year, ladies. Lila wants to start it up again, and she has heard some stuff from other ladies that want to do this. And so that will start up actually, the first one will be January 8th, which is the second. Usually it'll be the first and the third Mondays of the month, but for the month of January, it's going to be the second Monday because the first Monday is New Year's Day. And so, but subsequent months after that, February going forward, it'll always be the first and the third Mondays of the month. So that starts, again, January 8th, and is it at 6? At 6 o'clock. At the Sablons, again, Women's Fellowship Bible Study. Tonight, we are going to have Christmas caroling for anybody that wants to come. And make sure you bring your hiking boots because, you know, we're going to have to climb a lot of hills in Napa. No, I'm joking around. We're going to have a couple of trailers, and we do this every year. I think this is our fourth or fifth year. Yeah. And we usually set up a trailer and or two, and we get these hay bales, and we decorate the trailers with lights. And we have cocoa and hot cider out there. And we just, everybody sits on the trailer, and the trailer drives down the road, and we stop at the next house. We send one of the youth group kids who are really energetic and can run at a door and, you know, knock on the door and to get the people to come out. And then we sing a traditional Christmas song to them. So if you want to partake in that, that would be awesome. And we're also afterwards, because it's going to be probably a cold night. Well, it is, I checked. But no rain, thankfully, right? My wife's going to do taco soup and nachos after at our house for anybody that wants to fellowship with us after. And that's no pressure either way, coming or staying. But again, if you want to, it's a good way to, you know, just to partake and to bless some people out in our community and at the same time do fellowship afterwards. The next thing is Christmas baskets for needy families. We have six families that I'm aware of, six, bro. And We need a lot of help with that. We've already started buying, certain things for it, but, you know, we still could use help if someone wants to donate some presents for some of the kids from the families.
or if you want to donate food. And also, we're going to need help loading baskets and also loading up the car. And so, because we're going to actually take them, is that next week we're taking them? Right after service on Christmas Eve Day? So, yeah, so if you want to partake in that, please do. There's a lot of needy families in the community. I wish that we could have sponsored more, but I think this is our third year doing this, right? And every year it seems to be such a blessing to those families, but even more so to us, you know, to really appreciate the blessings that God has given us, you know. So if you want to love on somebody in the community, please help in some way. Even if you can't help monetarily with some type of an item, yeah, hands are definitely needed. And then, you know, just the normal things, guys, you know, we need volunteers to help at church, you know, refreshments, you know, at the greeting table. You know, if anybody wants to make a treat, you know, for after service, you normally have it there at the end of church. That's another way that you can help. And then I wanted to throw this plug out there, and I promise we're almost done. There's a lot of stuff going on. It's just, you know, that time of the year. But we are looking for a family or families who want to host a small group. You know, we believe that our, you know, we need to be in the community and we need to be doing things, you know, on Sunday, obviously, but outside of Sunday as well. There's 168 hours in a week. 2 hours on Sunday is hardly enough for us to really come together as a community and a family in Christ. So if God is moving your heart to do that, please talk to me or to Brother Tim. And I promise you, you won't have to know how to teach the Bible necessarily. We will get you a study guide. And Brother Justin used to do this very thing. He actually led our last small group that we had a couple years, a year and a half ago, whatever it was. And he just went right out of a book. You know, and so it's just somebody that has a heart to want to, again, do work for the kingdom. And then the final thing I want to say just on that same kind of wavelength is, you know, again, I don't want to just do ministry with all of you. We're brothers and sisters in Christ, and I hope that we can start doing more life together, especially in the coming year. And I don't mean, you know, necessarily out doing ministry. I'm talking about, hey, invite another family over to your house. I don't have to be there. You know, you guys are brothers and sisters in Christ. Maybe have a play date, you know, a couple of you have small children, have a play date with your families, you know, those types of things, you know. And I think if we do that, we're not only going to draw closer to each other, but I think our mission to reach this community with the gospel is really going to get on fire because the Lord, I think, is really going to bless that. Anyway, that's all I have for announcements. If the kids want to come up, and you guys don't need a mic, do you? Sister Helen, do you guys need a mic? Are you okay? Okay.
Thank you, Children's Church, and thank you, Sister Helen, and all the helpers that put that together. Such a blessing. If we can all stand for the Word of God, if you're able to. Psalm 128, 1 through 6, a song of ascents. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace be upon you. Peace be upon Israel.
Singing glory. Thank you.
Father, we just thank you again for today and just for the opportunity to worship you, God. We pray as we continue this service that your spirit would just continue to reign. God, we love you. We praise you. Thank you for Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So now's the time when we do prayers, and we do have a few prayers to mention today. I just want to, we see Diane here today, and you know, bless her heart, she wanted to be here with her church family. Can I tell, is that okay if I, okay. So she's got pneumonia, not contagious, don't worry. But, you know, she would like more continued prayer for her. And also, you know, just want to continue to praise the Lord that he didn't allow Dale to get sick. I mean, that was, you know, that was incredible because she's obviously having, she's Dale's caretaker. And so she's having to take care of him. And yet, and she's around him and, you know, he didn't get sick. I mean, wow, thank you, Jesus, you know. So I just want to praise the Lord for that. I also want to lift up, you know, just the people that are struggling with health issues, whether they go to our church or just people that have asked us to pray for people, just to lift up some names, Kenny Knight, Ricky Lawrence, JT, my daughter, Laura, her co-worker. If you can be praying, you know, for those folks and anybody else in our church that has any type of health things, you know. You know, bad health is a result of the fall. And so, you know, and Lord is, you know, he's the only and true physician and the only way that by which healing comes. And so we seek him in our healing. And so thank you, Lord. I also want to pray for the Jacobson Aguilar family. You know, Bodine, we just ask for healing and comfort for him. I will say that I don't know what it means for the long run, but he was kind of going downhill. But for the last week or so, he's actually been up. And we've been, I think every other day or so, that family texts us out pictures of Bodine and gives us like an update, you know. And so just continued prayer for them, for strength, for, you know, comfort and, you know, for healing, if it's God's will, for Bodine Jacobson. And then I just want to give a praise. You know, we are a small church, and I know that God's going to grow us. But I do praise the Lord for the unity of our church. You know, I love you guys so much, and I do appreciate you. I hope that I'm an encouragement to you at least as much as you are to me. And so I want to praise God for that unity. Because every time somebody needs something or something has to happen, it just like, seems like we just all come up and we step up for each other. And that's a mark of the Spirit. That's a mark of the love of Christ. So thank you all so much. Now I want to go ahead and open it up. Does anybody have prayer requests? Okay. Timothy, if we could be praying for Sherry's son, Timothy, his right eye, he's lost his vision. He has seen a doctor. But if we can just pray for healing, maybe God will just take care of it. Maybe it's a way of God, you know, calling to him, you know. But again, if we can just be praying. Somebody else have any prayer requests today? All right. Well, I'm going to go ahead then, and I'm just going to, first of all, just give you guys a minute to go ahead and just, you know, pray, you know, anything you want to lift up, and as well as some of the things that we've mentioned, and then I'll close out. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much, God, as we are in the season of the Advent, in the season of Christmas. We thank you so much that because of Jesus, because of his coming, because of his life, his death, his resurrection, because of him, God, we can confidently approach your throne of grace. We thank you that he makes it possible for all who are in him. We can freely come to you, God, and you receive us, God. And also, Lord, we thank you, God, that because we are your children,
again, because of Jesus, you hear our prayers, Lord. And we just want to lift up all these prayer requests that we have mentioned today. Want to say special prayers again for Diane Fish. Right now, God, praise the Lord, praise you. She does not have to take any antibiotics. I pray that would continue to be the case. I pray you would just clear her lungs out and that she would just be healed, God. I pray that that would happen immediately, but we also pray first for your timing, God, and we know it's going to be done, God. So we pray that healing upon Diane and continued protection of Dale, God, and health for him as well. We want to lift up our church, just that you would allow us to be a light in the community, God. It's not about filling up the building so much as it's about souls coming, that they would be saved. Souls receiving your perfect gift, Jesus Christ, Lord, salvation. So I pray, God, that you would allow us to be that light, the hands and the feet of Jesus in our community, God, and give us opportunities to reach out and love on people. Also want to pray for the people with health issues that we're aware of and those that we're not, but I will name Kenny Knight, Ricky Lawrence, and JT now to you, God, as well as Bodine Jacobson. God, place your healing hand upon all of them. And we just pray by the power of your Spirit in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus, that they would just be healed, God. And again, Lord, just want to lift up unspoken prayers. I just want to lift up those prayers that maybe we are aware of but didn't want to mention, or maybe we just forgot, God. I know that you know all things. We know that, God. So I just pray your hand would be in those things and you would answer prayer, God. Again, we love you. We praise you. Thank you for Jesus. And again, just let your Spirit reign here now as you speak your word through Brother Tim, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. It is Christmas time. Obviously, I brought my tie back out again. I think I got one more week I can still get it in. We'll see if I can do it next week and maybe keep my dinner off it today so it doesn't have to be cleaned. But it's that time we're in full scope of that celebration, right? We've got trees up. We've got lights. We're buying presents. We're getting ready to go. And we're getting ready to celebrate. Next week will be the apex. I mean, school's already out. The scene is being set. And next week on Sunday, we're going to be at the apex of all of our thing there. And then it'll just be kind of easing on down through the rest of the holidays there from then on. But as we celebrate, we look forward to the coming of the Savior. We actually look backwards to his first coming, but we look forward to his second coming. Because just like he came the first time unexpectedly, he's going to come unexpectedly again for us. Today we're going to finish up the book of Colossians before we get into that. So I'll let Dave next week hit Christmas. But I am going to finish up Colossians. So if you'll turn with me, chapter 4, starting in verse 2 through the end. It's going to seem a little bit odd. I think it's probably part of the places that we skip when we start reading in the Bible. I think there's some good things in there. Continue earnestly in prayer, being vigilant in it with thanksgiving. Meanwhile, praying also for us that God would open us a door for the word, to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I also am in chains, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you might answer each one. Tychicus, a beloved brother, faithful minister, and fellow servant in the Lord, will tell you all the news about me. I am sending him to you for this very purpose, that he may know your circumstances and comfort your hearts. With Onesimus, a faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will make known to you all the things which are happening here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, with Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, about whom you received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justice, these are my only fellow workers for the kingdom of God, who are of the circumcision. They have proved to be a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a bondservant of Christ, greets you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has a great zeal for you and those who are in Laodicea, and those in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, and Demas greet you. Greet the brethren who are in Laodicea, and Nymphas, and the church that is in his house. Now when this epistle is read among you, see that it is read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and that you likewise read the epistle from Laodicea. And I say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord, that you may fulfill it. This salutation by my own hand, Paul. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given us the word through Paul, that you have written instructions both for these people there and for us here. Lord, we thank you that you love and care for us and that we are one body with many gifts. And we just ask that you would bless this time together and that you would speak to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. We start out here and we get to continue earnestly in prayer. But look how he says to do it. When I think continue earnestly in prayer, I sometimes get a little bit guilty or feel a little bit guilty. And that's because I always associate it with a verse in 1 Thessalonians 5:17. It says, pray without ceasing. And I think, how do you do that? I mean, how do you pray without ceasing? Sometimes I'm learning to drive, or sometimes I'm teaching how to drive, you know. And those are not times that I should be bowing my head, I don't think. It could be a lot of other things that go along with that. But when he tells us that we should be praying earnestly, that we should continue earnestly in this, he's saying that we should have a demeanor that's always continually looking to God. It's not something that we have to be bowing our head continually. It's not something that that we're continually in the back of our mind, even though we're out in the world looking at people and talking to people, that somehow we're able to run another script of prayer, asking him for things and praising him for things and thanking him for things. But it's that we have a heart that continually looks back to him. Definitely daily, probably hourly, and could be even by the minute. So often I know in my life that I was lucky. A lot of things came easy to me when I was a kid. I had a lot of older brothers and sisters, and so when I went to school, it wasn't new to me. My dad was a school teacher, and so I kind of knew what to expect, and things kind of came easy to me. But as a result, I continually think that I can do things myself and don't need to ask God. And I think that any of us can get into that in any of our spheres that we get into, to where we start to feel confident, to where we start to feel gifted, to where we start to feel these things. And instead of turning to him in prayer for all the things that we are facing, we do it of our own strength. It's gotten me into trouble many of times. He says, continue earnestly in prayer by being vigilant. First to do it without ceasing, but then to be vigilant. What does he mean by that? I think he means not just rote. When Dave comes up and leads prayer, especially when I do it on a weekly basis, it becomes hard not to say the same things over and over and over. If you come from a Catholic background, Hail Marys. Right? There's a lot of these sorts of things that we think that mere incantation of words is what God wants, but it's not. It's not to say that these are always bad, but when he says to be vigilant, he means that it's not to be mindless, not to be rote, but it's to be changing to the needs and the environment around us. Our prayers should be continual and continually changing to the needs and the environment around us. Paul gives these believers in Colossians another way of praying too. He brings up other believers. He says, hey, pray for us. Pray for us while I'm here in my chains. We should be doing the same. We should be praying for our brothers and sisters in Christ. I know it's an encouragement every week. Dave will write something about praying for your brothers, da 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 da. Thinking of you, brothers, da 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 da, right? I'll get a little text like that. It's what we should be doing. It's a good example. We should be praying for other believers and the things that God is having them do. And lastly, I see here, praying for God's mission. How does he say it? He says, open a door for the word to speak the mystery of Christ, right? One, that's Paul's, but that I make it manifest. God has a mission here, and it's that Paul would come in contact. Paul would be able to explain the mysteries of Christ to those around him. Wherever he was at, he would be able to get the message of Jesus Christ across to them. And we need to be doing the same things, praying that God would allow us to fulfill his mission here, praying that God would allow us to fulfill our mission in our families, praying that God would allow us to fulfill his mission in our communities, praying that God would allow us to fulfill our mission in this country that he's placed us in. Paul knows, as he's giving these instructions to the Colossians, he knows that prayer is vital. It's so vital that it can't be left off. It has to be continual. It has to be vigilant, changing to the needs and environments. It needs to be praying for other believers and praying for God and his mission as well. Then he comes back and he says at the end of verse 5 there, 5 and 6, he comes and he says something a little bit differently. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. How do we redeem the time? One, he says, walk in wisdom toward those who are outside. Too often we get a certain personality or a certain program that we're doing, and we want to do it that way all the time. Who's heard of Campus Crusade? Okay. Bill Bright put out a little booklet on the gospel that's called The Four Spiritual Laws. And it's great. And it stinks. And that's not dogging him. I think he was fulfilling the mission God had for him. But if I go and I use that every time in all situations, sometimes I can repel people from hearing the gospel more than I can have them listen to the gospel. Here he says, walk in wisdom toward those who are outside. Understand what the needs, the desires, the passions, the wants, the foibles, the strengths of those who are around you. He wants us to think about them and walk in wisdom with what they need. He says, speak with grace. Let your speech always be with grace. Too oftentimes, I want to go, oh, that idiot. Can you believe what they did? Obviously, I wasn't earnestly in prayer, continually vigilant and walking in wisdom with those around me when I was thinking such things. But I do it. But here Paul says, no, don't do that, Tim. He says, speak with grace. Understand where the other person is coming from. Understand what their needs are, what their desires are, how to meet them where they're at. But it's not all, oh, I'm so glad you're doing what you're doing. Oh, right? Because that's what the world wants to tell us that we should be doing. Oh, you don't support me if we don't cheer them on in whatever they're doing. No, we speak with grace, but a grace that is seasoned with salt. What does salt do? Basically, two things. According to Levi, it adds a lot of flavor because he loves it. He'll put salt on a lot. And I think a lot of us are that way, right? But it's also a preservative. It's something that allows something to keep from spoiling. So sometimes my speech has to be something that confronts some other person, not because I'm looking for conflict, but because if I'm going to give that person grace, if I'm going to walk in wisdom of what they really need long term, I must confront them with some truths of where their life does not match up with what God would have. Then I am seasoning my speech with salt. I'm giving it something interesting, and I'm preserving their life. And four, on redeeming the time, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. Like I said in the beginning there, study those around you. 1 Peter 3:15, I'm going to read from there in just a second. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile you for your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. But always be ready. Always be ready for an answer that meets that person. He gives us a few simple things about redeeming our time and continuing earnestly in prayer. And I think it's so good, because so often I get to my life and I start going through life and it gets a crazy week like this week, and you got people getting ready for Christmas, you're going shopping, you're doing these extra little things everywhere, you're going to a party here, you're going caroling there, you're taking somebody to a doctor that something came up that you didn't expect in the middle of all of it, right? And I lose sight of what we really should be about. Because really our time should be about redeeming the time and bringing a picture of Christ and wisdom to those around us, both believers and especially in our families, but also outside. It shouldn't be about me accomplishing 8 million tasks or showing up to 4 million parties or meetings or whatever it happens to be. But in the end, redeeming the time comes down to understanding that we are on a mission for God. That we, through prayer and reliance on Him, are bringing about His kingdom and matching Him and what He needs and wants from us. And that in the end, He's chosen us. Can you imagine that? The God of the universe came here, died, went through all that peace, and then He said, you know, Chris, I need some help, bud. What? You need help from me? You mean you can't say that better than I can? You can't run that faster than I can? You can't think that through better than I can? You can't keep track of more details than I can? What do you need me for again? But it's like the mom that has the little kid at home and she's in the kitchen and gets help. It's not about the mom getting the task accomplished. It's much more about God training us through those tasks. So Paul says, continue earnestly in prayer, but he also says, redeem the time. God has a mission for you. Redeem the time. And now we move into that part that I think that we oftentimes skip, the final greetings. Oh, okay, it's just the end. I get it, and I go on. What am I going to get from that? But I want to encourage you, every word is there for our benefit. 2 Timothy 3:16. Let me pull that up for you. All Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. And that man there is the generic man, meaning man and woman. All Scripture, even these little pieces, even those genealogies, ugh, in the Old Testament, right? But there's pieces there to be learned. One thing I like to do that I've learned over time and that can be rewarding is look at what the names in the Bible mean. You know, we hear a name, Timothy or Mark or Heather or whatever it is, and it's a name to us. We don't really think of it as a separate meaning. But most of these names in the Bible are more like an Indian name, you know, like Chief Running Bear or, you know, these different, they describe something about the person's character. They describe something about what they do. They give us other things. And because it's in a language we don't know and the translators didn't translate the word, we lose something in there about what it is. So I thought I'd take us on a little tour of some of these names here. So, Tychicus, a beloved brother, right? Do you know what his name means? Fortunate. Fortunate. Onesimus, useful, profitable, or beneficial. So Paul is sending, fortunately, someone, a couple of people who are useful, profitable, and beneficial to make sure that they all know what's going on with him. Okay? You see how that? Sometimes it tells us about the person himself. Sometimes it actually tells us about what's going on with the story. Aristarchus. He's a Thessalonian who accompanied Paul to Rome when Paul got thrown in prison. There's a loyal guy. Here's one I like. Jesus, right? But he doesn't go by Jesus, because I think that would probably be hard in the early church, don't you think? I mean, I know that there's quite a few people with Spanish names, Jesus, but I think at some point it probably gets confusing, and it probably really did here when Jesus was the focus of everything they did. So he goes by Justice, which means, just like it sounds, upright, just. Okay. Epaphras. Lovely. And again, he talks about praying for the maturity of believers. Is there anything more lovely than a mature believer? Is there anything more beautiful than someone who is fully following God and mature in them? Don't they bring us to new heights? Like looking at a piece of art that drops your jaw, right? That's the same thing that somebody who's walked with the Lord for a long time and knows them well does. Luke and Mark. Luke is light-giving. Mark was originally shining, and then it had some other connotations about Mars and some other things like that, but originally was shining. So the two gospel writers that we see mentioned in this little bit here, right? Light-giving and shining. Oh, they're telling us about the light-giving and the shining. It's just interesting how knowingly or unknowingly, their parents named them in these ways, or they were named in these ways, and God had a purpose that was going to be fulfilled with that. We're going to come back to Mark as well. Barnabas, son of encouragement. I think a lot of people know that one. Mark and Barnabas are actually, it's a little bit back and forth here, but an uncle and a nephew or cousins. Depends on how you look at it. And it's, you think, well, how could they be so mixed up that you can't figure that out? Well, I'll tell you a little story. When I was in Ukraine, I was learning just like everybody learns, and you learn oftentimes about family and how to introduce yourself. And you say, so, you know, my name's Tim. I have three brothers. I have two sisters. My mom is this old. You know, you go through the whole piece, right? And I'd meet these people, and they said that they lived in a one-room apartment with their parent, and that there were no other kids in the house. Okay. And then the next week, I'd hear them talking to somebody else, and they'd be talking about their brother. I go, wait, what's this brother you're talking about? And then the next week, you might hear about a sister. And you go, wait, what's this sister you're talking about? Well, in some languages, these things, you have to get by context, and if we've lost a little bit of the context, you can lose a little bit of the meaning. Or you can change a letter or two here or there, and we're going to find one of those here in a little bit too. But in Ukrainian, you called your cousin your second brother, and your second cousin was your third brother, and on out like that. But they never said first brother, second brother, third brother. They just said brother. And so I was walking around confused for a long time till I figured this out. I'd hear, wait, because my head wouldn't take it. Let's look at Demas. Demas means popular. Popular. And I think this is probably the one that impacted me the most when I was a kid or a young man. Everybody remember the story of Mark and Barnabas? Mark wrote the Gospel of Mark. He's probably the young man that loses his robe when they're after Jesus and he's running away because he's scared, spitless. And then he goes on Paul's first missionary journey, and partway through, he gets scared and he goes home to mama. And then he wants to go on the second missionary journey, and Paul says, absolutely not. There is no way he's going with me, not over my dead body. And then him and Barnabas have a big fight because Barnabas says, hey, come on, give him a break. That's why I probably think it's a nephew. At least if he's a cousin, he's probably quite a little bit older. But it started out pretty poor, right? Immature Mark, he runs off because he's afraid. Then he gets another place, and he's afraid again, and he's not going to follow the things that God would have him do. He's overcome by his fear so badly that the great apostle Paul says, uh-uh, don't want to see him, don't want to have him, Okay? He goes along, and then we see here in Colossians, and it's basically, see if I can find his name. Greets you with Mark, the cousin of Barnabas. Receive instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. He's basically saying, okay, he's back around me. We also know that Mark from history was around the Apostle Peter a lot. That's probably where he wrote most of his gospel, was from the sayings of Peter, listening to him preach. And then if you turn, and we'll look there a little bit later, into 1 Timothy chapter 4, he actually says about Mark, send him to me, for he is useful to me in ministry, Paul does. So as poor as his life began in Christ, as little as he showed about capacity or ability, there's something about his faith that kept him going and kept him serving and made him useful in ministry to the great apostle Paul, one of the smartest men that's lived, somebody who was walking with God and totally empowered by God. And Paul says, send him to me, for he's useful in ministry. Demas is a little less well known because he didn't write a gospel. But here and in Philemon, just like Mark, he's commended as a fellow worker of Paul's. It's kind of a neutral or a positive thing, depending on how you look at it. But let's turn now to 1 Timothy 4 and verses 10 and 11. For to this end we both labor and suffer reproach, because, am I in four? It's probably 2 Timothy. There we go. For Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, and has departed for Thessalonica. Crescens for Galatia, Titus for Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful to me for ministry. Notice the two differences of these two men. Demas starts out well. And what was his name again? Do we remember? Popular. Oh, and how does he leave? He leaves because he loved this present world. He was seeking his popularity. As he seeks his popularity, he loses his understanding. He loses his following of God and serving him, and he abandons it. I would hope that at some point he changed back from that, but we have no record of it in the Bible. The record in the Bible is that he started out well, but ended poorly, and left because he loved this present world more than he loved serving the Lord. While Mark, on the other hand, represents most of us as well, we started out poorly in sin, not following God and needing his help. And yet our God is gracious and has a lot of patience and takes our poor little faith that's scared and wondering if we can do things. And as we continue to walk with him and serve him and pray earnestly, continually in walking with him in prayer, redeeming the time, he redeems us and builds us up and makes us people who are useful to him in ministry. So you see, even these ends of a book where we've learned so much from Colossians about what Paul wrote to them, even these last little endings where he just encourages us to continue in prayer and redeem the time, and then gives a bunch of greetings, we see that he still is telling his story, that all scripture is God-breathed and profitable. And so I would encourage you today, continue earnestly in prayer. Pray without ceasing, be vigilant to the changing needs and environment around you. Pray for other believers and pray for God's mission where you are at. Redeem the time. Walk in grace. Walk in wisdom, sorry. Speak with grace. Speak speech that is seasoned with salt. And impact those around you. Because then we can end up as Mark, who God takes and forgives and redeems and builds up and makes useful like Onesimus. Because otherwise there's a chance that we end up like Demas. People who thought it was cool or something else for a bit, even called him Lord and thought we were serving him, but walk away because we loved being popular or loving this present world. So Timberland, I ask today, remember, continue in prayer and redeem the time. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you that you do look at us, that you take us in our fears and in our imperfections and our immaturity. But as we continue to try to follow you imperfectly, you redeem us, that you redeem our capacities and our abilities and make us useful. We love you because you first loved us. We look forward to your coming, and we celebrate your first coming so that you could die on the cross to do that. Help us to be like Mark and not like Demas. Help us to continue with you all the days of our lives. Help us to be strong and courageous for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now is the time we're going to do communion. We do this monthly. In this time of Christmas, I know often, we don't see some of the things that we normally do in church necessarily directly connected
to the Christmas story. But the truth is that communion is definitely, connected. There's symbols there within the communion ceremony that point, to the Christmas story. And I don't want to talk too long just for the sake of time, but I do want to give you this picture, if I may, that when we take the symbols, and obviously there's the bread and then there's the juice, the bread specifically, at least in regards to the Christmas story, I don't know if you guys realize this or not, but, it is unleavened bread. There is no yeast in the bread. And so it's a flat bread. This is something that goes all the way back to the time of Moses when, the people were being delivered out of Egypt. God said to, make unleavened bread. When Jesus had broke bread, the bread that he broke was unleavened, no yeast bread. And yeast in the Bible often represents sin. Jesus being the perfect unblemished lamb, the bread of life, if you will, was without sin. And there's two times that we know this. We know this when Jesus started his ministry. Before then, he was tempted, remember that? And the enemy was unable to tempt him to sin. And then we read about it in Hebrews that Jesus lived a life, a full life, and yet he was without sin. One thing we often don't realize, or maybe we forget, is that Jesus was born of a virgin through the Immaculate Conception. And so he was born by the Spirit of God. Do you guys understand? And so even his birth was a sinless birth. It was unleavened, if you will. And so as we go to take the elements, be mindful of that what we are taking is it represents obviously the bread and the wine, but the bread represents the sinless Lamb of God. Sinless from the very beginning. Sinless from his birth all the way to his death and then resurrected and ascended to heaven. Be mindful of that as we take the elements right now. I want to go ahead and go to 1 Corinthians 11 and just read to you what Paul writes regarding the Last Supper. But before I do, I would like everybody to please go ahead and prepare your heart to receive communion. Confess, to the Lord any sin. Ask the Holy Spirit to prepare your heart to receive it. And then pray for somebody that you know that God has in your life that doesn't know the Lord. Pray that they would come to know the Lord and be saved, receiving that free gift that Jesus came such a far distance to give. I'll give you guys a minute. First Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Please take the bread.
In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Please take the juice. And Heavenly Father, we do praise you and we thank you, God. As all of us fall short, all of us miss the mark, all of us can't reach the standard of Jesus, God, who is the standard, who again entered the earth sinless, walked through life, lived out his life sinless, carried out his mission and his ministry sinless, and yet he died for the sins of the world. And because of his righteousness and his sinless life, his him being the unblemished Lamb of God, he rose from the dead. And we thank you, God, that by your grace, through faith in the blood of Jesus, in the life of Jesus, in the sacrifice of Jesus, in the sinless of Jesus, you impute his righteousness on each of us, and you hold not our sins against us. We thank you for Jesus again. We just ask, God, that we'd be ever mindful, definitely during this Advent season, God, but even more every moment of our lives, God. As Brother Tim said, that we would be praying without ceasing, excuse me, and we would speak graciously to those outside, and that we would be preservers of souls, God. Again, Lord, for your glory, we love you and we praise you, God. Thank you for Jesus, again, who makes all things possible. And again, thank you for your Spirit, God, that your Spirit reign in the rest of this service, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sinners hear the silent word.
Father, we thank you for this service again and for everybody that you brought, God. We just pray as we leave that we would go in peace, God, that we would go in the mission field and be light unto you, God. Again, we love you. We praise you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for your spirit, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. Have a blessed week. Hope to see you tonight at Caroling.